This morning, we will start a new sermon series on Thanksgiving. I will be reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 19 to 21. Jesus says, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also."
Thanks so much, Bernie. Alrighty. In 1922, I don't think any of us were on. Well, maybe. I don't know. I don't think so. That was 98 years ago. Howard Carter. Anybody know the name? No? Come on, we're getting into the history books. A British archaeologist. What did Howard Carter do in 1922? He chiseled his way through the entrance to a buried tomb in Egypt. So I hopefully can click this along. Oh no, don't tell me the battery. There we go. This is an actual picture of the location of Howard Carter discovering the tomb of King Tutankhamun. All right, that was a huge thing. This discovery, it was remarkable. So I think I got a little picture. There we go. There he is inside this tomb looking at the sarcophagus of King Tutankhamun. And of course, this tomb contained an incredible amount of treasure. You can see this. This picture's been colorized, by the way. It was not a color photo in 1922. They went back in and added some extra ink. But there you go, a little glimpse of what was so amazing to find in this tomb of the Pharaoh, King Tutankhamun. Now, I have a picture here of the mask that was placed over the mummy of King Tutankhamun. It's a gold mask made of solid gold weighing 24 pounds. So just to give you a little bit of understanding of what that thing is worth today, when I checked at the time at $1,894 per ounce of gold, that's roughly $727,296 today. Just that mask. It is absolutely incredible. This was an exceptional discovery because there was actually treasure in this tomb. Now, the rule of the day was that no one would really expect to find any sort of treasure and valuable possessions belonging to the pharaohs when their tombs were discovered. Why? Well, because that treasure over all of those centuries and thousands of years, well, would certainly have been discovered already. And certainly have been robbed. No one can just look at a mask like that and say, I don't need it. That's not worth anything to me. They were robbed, or at the very least destroyed by the elements or just nature, critters getting inside these tombs. Almost no discoveries of ancient tombs came with the discovery of intact treasures that were once a valued possession to the deceased within that tomb. Now, what also stuns the world in regards to the ancient tombs of the pharaohs, especially when they actually are full of treasure, is the thought that all those material treasures were buried with them so that they can have them in the afterlife. That was the idea. That was the point. We, the living, and thousands of years later, open these tombs and see the truth. We just say, wow, look at all of this stuff that those pharaohs thought that they could take with them. Little did they know it would just collect dust in those dark tombs. Nothing the deceased were buried with made it with them to the afterlife. Nothing. I bring all of this up today because Jesus in Matthew 6, 19 through 21 speaks to that reality that the deceased take nothing with them. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moths and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal. We are in the part of Matthew where Jesus is giving his Sermon on the Mount. Jesus is seated on a hill and he has a remarkable amount of people in front of him listening to his every word. This is an incredible scene right now in Matthew. Some in the crowd are true followers. Some in the crowd are not. And some in the crowd do not know what to think of this Jesus, of this rabbi. Now, at this point in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus has been speaking on many different aspects to what life is like for those who truly fear God and pursue his holiness. And Jesus is speaking with such authority. Truly, Jesus is speaking in the eyes and ears and hearts of the people gathered there at this time as one who speaks for God. He has that air about him, such authority. And some in this crowd are amazed by this. Some are kind of confused by this. Some are even angry at this, at Jesus. Again, what it would have been like to be seated there on that hill while listening. Well, as was just said, Jesus is speaking about what life is like for a child of God who truly fears God. And today's text arrives to that subject of material blessings. And it is truly a big subject because, well, who here likes being told what to do with their stuff? Most of us probably like making our own decisions when it comes to our stuff. We go through much work and effort, do we not, to get that stuff, to maintain that stuff, to keep that stuff safe and protected. It's rather instinctual, I would believe, to be a little sensitive about all of that. I'm the same way. Don't touch my bike. Don't touch my road bike. That's my treasure. Leave it alone. I even keep it hidden away in the basement until I actually want to ride it because I don't even want it to get a little scratch, right? We protect our stuff, do we not? We treasure it. And so do the Israelites. They had those same instincts all the way back then, 2,000 or so years ago. In fact, amongst this crowd, there's actually a particular group of Israelites that had a very particular viewpoint about stuff and possessions. And Jesus is most certainly actually kind of critiquing them. He's kind of criticizing them at this point. This group is called the Pharisees. We're going to learn about them in this moment. This particularly legalistic group of Israelites, they believed that material blessings in this life were the direct result of true faithfulness. Now this viewpoint, again, I'll say it again, that material blessings in this life were the direct result of true faithfulness, this viewpoint is hugely problematic. There's a problem here with that thought. So let's explore some of the implications of what the Pharisees thought and taught. They were a powerful group. We, of course, can read the New Testament, and we constantly read of the Pharisees. So here's one of the problems. First, believing that material blessing in this life is the result of true faith, it actually lowers the purpose of faith. There's actually nothing everlasting about this faith with this kind of viewpoint. It only exists to serve us in the now. It actually kind of creates no everlasting need for God because all of your focus is on life now, not on what is to come. It does nothing to solve the problem of death. So that's one problem with this viewpoint. Here's a second one. The idea that true faith is only present if people are materially blessed, it takes away, it actually kind of belittles, and it makes worthless the real faith of practically every, It actually makes worthless the real faith of practically every man and woman and child in this world. At what point could someone measure their material blessings and confidently say that they have arrived at true faith? That's kind of the implications here. At what point? This viewpoint that the Pharisees were carrying about themselves, they were teaching, they were spreading, it creates a hierarchy of faith within our human existence. And it encourages a hierarchy of human value against each other. It makes us look to the other and say, I'm better than you, or you're better than me. Why? Because you must have more faith than me because you have more stuff, you're more blessed, you have a more comfortable life. Truly, you are a better person than I am. That's what that viewpoint does. And again, it does nothing to solve that problem of death. If anything, it just degrades people. It degrades us. What a mess this viewpoint can create. It creates a system of people who warp their faith into the ultimate pursuit of stuff. Possessions, comfort, treasures, fulfilling our own desires. And like I said earlier, there's just no everlasting hope in this pursuit. It ignores the everlasting and it focuses on the now. There's no conquering of sin and death, and there's really kind of no ultimate point to love God or to really love each other. So the Pharisees, they were living into a viewpoint that made life all about me. Me, me, me. So the Pharisees, they had created a false theology that reflected the broken world rather than reflecting the nature of God. Rather than a God who loved his children, even despite their sin, they kind of created a new God, a God who awarded human self-righteousness. That's what happens with this viewpoint. Rather than
a loving God because of his grace and mercy and love despite our sin. They actually created a God who was not to be loved, but rather just made not angry. Because again, you got to get that stuff. You got to be faithful to get that stuff. Rather than keeping faith in God no matter what happens in this life, they created a God who was to be abandoned if there was no stuff being bestowed upon you. I don't need that God if he's doing nothing for me. That's kind of what the Pharisees created there. Who needs God if you don't get any good stuff out of it? If there's no results that come out of this? With the viewpoint of the Pharisees, that's kind of the ultimate question. And we must be honest with ourselves here. Is that the question we actually ask ourselves? Maybe we don't ask that question directly, but do we live out that question with how we respond to our material blessings, to the comfort or discomfort we receive in this life? When we get the Christmas bonus, do we praise God? Probably most of us do or did when we were getting Christmas bonuses at the time, right? But how about when we get fired from our job, or our house gets damaged, or our car gets taken away, or we go into debt, or our health fails us? Do we praise God for his presence in our lives, for who he is? Or do we question the point of God and his work in our lives? You see, I know, because I'm part of this too. I do this myself. I think we all act kind of like a Pharisee every once in a while when it comes to our stuff. Jesus, he knows this. Of course, Jesus knows this. He knew this great struggle of God's children while he taught upon the hill here in Matthew 6. And he knows this great struggle of ours today while he sits at the right hand of God the Father. Jesus knows our hearts instinctually want to collect things so that we can feel safe, so that we can feel secure, so that we can feel comfortable. Because why? The world is so harsh. It's too hard. We need that comfort. This is why our text for today exists. Jesus is speaking directly to the heart of the real problem, and he is speaking directly to our hearts. Because as we know with the Pharaohs, our instincts to collect and have stuff actually do not line up with what will solve our fears and problems. Again, thinking about those Pharaohs, we can all marvel at the obvious truth that not a single one of those kings of old got to bring a single coin with them in death. Not 1 ounce of that gold of King Tut made it with him to the afterlife. Death is that threshold each one of us knows about. And death is that threshold each one of us knows cannot be crossed with any possession. Any of those things we instinctually reach out for in this life. Jesus knows. He knows that our hearts break at the finality of death. So hear Jesus' words again from Matthew 6, this time 20 through 21. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So to help Israel, to help us with solving the real problem here, not that problem of being necessarily comfortable in this life, but more so that ultimate problem of death, of having that everlasting hope and a future we all crave and need, we of course can celebrate several things about what Jesus says here in this text, to put our eyes, our hopes on heaven. So first, when Jesus is saying this, he is helping us understand God, the true purpose of God, that truth of God. Jesus is teaching us to keep our hearts focused on the everlasting truth and power of God. That's the real treasure. God's presence in our lives. The one who made us and shaped us, who gave us life, who breathed life into us. He's the one that's going to solve that problem of death. Put your hopes in God. With the authority of the Son of God, Jesus is wiping away kind of the filth, if you will, of thinking that life is all about stuff and that God is all about rewarding us with stuff. And he's replacing it with the eternal treasure of God's truth, God's holy presence, God's work of salvation for his people. That's what Jesus is doing here in this text, on this Sermon on the Mount, in front of all these wandering people, these children of God, these Israelites. So second, Jesus is also helping us to understand kind of that this life we live now does have actually a remarkable purpose for our stuff. There is great value in our stuff, but it's not just there to serve our own needs, but rather to be used to care for others and proclaim that everlasting truth we just covered. Our stuff is there as a tool to be used to help proclaim God's truth. It's here that I conclude a little side note, kind of encouraging us to not really feel guilty about having material blessings. That's not the point of all this, to suddenly dump guilt on us for having stuff in the first place. This is not a call to give up all of our things for an empty and pointless reason also. Rather, and as exampled by the rich man who speaks with Jesus later on in Matthew 19, if you want to read that passage later on today, Jesus is challenging us. He's challenging God's people, God's children, to consider what place our material possessions have in our life. Do we understand that we can't take it with us when death comes? We can't. Do we understand the power as well that our material blessings have in helping others, in giving them just a glimpse of what it means for God to care for his people through us caring for others, through that first step of sharing our blessings with them? Do we see all of that as a gift to be used for Jesus? So third, and the last one, Jesus is helping us to live into a life that is not controlled by the fear of death and suffering, but by the joy and the thanksgiving of life everlasting in God. In today's passage, we see Jesus, who was and did go to the cross for us, releasing us of the burden of feeling insignificant because of suffering, because of lacking material possessions, because of not being blessed in that way, because of even death knocking on our door. We could potentially feel so insignificant when we're experiencing all those things. And yet Jesus Christ is showing us that we can have a greater hope that surpasses all of that. We have the generosity of God's heart in our lives. We have his presence as exampled here in our text by Jesus Christ, the very Son of God. So our passage for today, as we conclude this morning, it shows us that a truly generous heart, a heart willing to share, in recognition that God first shared his love, his Son, with us, our text shows that a generous heart has an everlasting hope. A generous heart has an everlasting hope. So may this Thanksgiving season, amidst all these difficulties and sufferings that surely we are experiencing, may this Thanksgiving season be one that all of us can practice generosity with a little bit more freedom, a little less fear, and certainly more joy and hope in our everlasting treasure that is Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's pray. God our Father, thank you for this day, and thank you for this time where we can physically gather together and give you praise. We can hear your word and reflect on the treasure of Jesus Christ. So God, thank you for how you do bless us with many, many blessings. God, may we use those blessings, not just for ourselves, but to show others the light of your glory, of what it means to be loved by God. May we not think that we have to just hoard all these things to ourselves, but may we be free to share and to give. So Jesus, you may be praised. Help us in that great mission. We pray all these things in your name, Jesus. Amen.